Hello. I'd like to introduce Dr. Scott.
This is the annual pre-spring break concert and even a little winter. We are in advance wishing everybody a happy and safe and fun spring vacation that's coming up. And this is a rare opportunity, I think, because one of the great things about teaching Westminster is that you guys are very, very musical, you're very artistic. And there are lots of students involved in performing arts and visual arts. There are lots of you that are not, but you still play and you sing and you draw and you paint and sculpt and dance and act. And that's, I think, one of the great crown jewels of Westminster, is it's such a super creative place. And so this is a chance to engage in a live music experience, which is not all that common these days, right? Because most of us experience music individually with earbuds or AirPods and do it on our own time. But the chance to be in a live room means that you have a couple of things very different. One is you have analog music. So you're hearing music as it really exists. Now this is the most horrid space on the planet for acoustics. You probably know that by now. But nonetheless, we do a lot of artistic stuff in this room. But you're gonna hear music as it comes out with perfection and flaws. And you're gonna hear all the frequencies. If you're listening to compressed music on an MP3, somebody, an engineer, a committee, has scrubbed out frequencies so that it will fit into a compressed file. It's usually middle frequencies, like French horns and human voices. That's kind of a middle range. So you have a chance to hear analog music versus something that's been kind of hygienically cleansed in a digital way. And you're getting to have energy in the room. So when you attend a live event, whether it's you and a friend playing guitar or a giant concert like this, you have a social experience out here in the audience, and you have a social experience kind of exchanging energy with the musicians on the stage, maybe the friends you know. And that's a special experience. And so I recommend that you take advantage of opportunities throughout your life to both hear recorded music and to hear live music with real musicians. When you're at a concert, we usually have a routine where the lights switch and the audience gets quiet and the concertmaster, in this case Maymay, comes out and we tune the orchestra and then the conductor comes up. We've kind of fast-forwarded through that today. And the listening to abstract music is a little different mode, right? Because our attention spans are very, very short these days. The average shot length in a Hollywood feature action film is 2.3 seconds. Video games probably less than a second, right? As many stimulating screen changes take place. So we're kind of taught that we need a change of visual scene very frequently, and that doesn't happen here. They're just going to be sitting up there and you'll be able to see some movement. But it's not going to be quite as stimulating as watching like 1917, right? There's going to be a lot more static visual field. So when you're listening to music, I'd recommend approaching it the same way that you do in Shakespeare or historical narratives or when you're doing anything in your classes that have to do with storytelling. So music is just storytelling sounds. And so we're going to have some kind of introduction, some kind of middle section, some kind of ending, like a good essay. We're going to say something, we're going to show you how good we're saying it, and we're going to tell you what we said. And that's kind of the theme of storytelling and music. The selections that we have for you today are old and new. The first selection that you're going to hear is about 200 years old. The second selection is about 6 months old. And the second selection is from film music. It's a suite of pieces from Star Wars 7, The Force Awakens. And it's likely that if you are under the age of 42 in this room, you have not known a world without Star Wars. It's always been here. And if you're slightly more experienced than 42, you remember Star Wars coming out in 1977. I was in third grade when my dad took me to see it. And you've known the music of John Williams all of your life. He's 88 and still working every day, getting up at 5:30 to start working at 6, which is pretty remarkable. Most nominated composer, actually most nominated living person of any category for Academy Awards, 52, I think, and second in history. So pretty incredible composer and someone who I think is probably the most impactful, most important composer of the 20th and 21st centuries. And then I would recall, where are all my Jam Term alumni, music in the movies? Yeah, so a bunch of you here. This is Mrs. Beasley. I just finished our sixth trip to Los Angeles and the class, which really has as its primary takeaway understanding how to be a really critical listener and coming to understand how music and media manipulate you. I don't say that necessarily in a bad way, but they affect us. And I would say the most important skill of your life, really, is that your understanding of what's true and what's real in the world is going to always be coming from a screen. And so you have to be screen literate to understand what content is coming at you and how that can be changed based on who's providing the content. The Force Awakens is a three-part suite, so you'll hear The March of the Resistance, which probably some of you have heard at Disney World if you've gone to the big Star Wars show down there, and then Rey's theme, followed by the scherzo for X-Wings. I want to thank Jonas Du from Studio W for putting together a cool video montage, so you will get some video with music. The first piece is by Ludwig von Beethoven. Most of you have heard of Beethoven. He is usually grouped with the big triumvirate of famous classical composers, with Bach and Mozart and Beethoven. He is 250 years old this year. He was actually born in December, so we'll probably be celebrating Beethoven themes for about 2 years. And I think Beethoven is the most important of all of the dead white German male composers. He is the one who affected everything after him. And thankfully now we have voices of other non-white German dead men coming to the fore. A lot of our classical Western canon is from that area. Beethoven was interesting, I think, to all of us because he was most like us. He didn't just write stuff down. He struggled and he worked and he labored and suffered from depression before we had a name for it. He had a really kind of rough life, and as many of you know, he had paradoxically the saddest situation for composers. He went progressively deaf over the course of his lifetime, and actually he was mostly deaf by the time he wrote the piece that we're about to play for you. But I think Beethoven is a really important person for you to understand that is, maybe Mozart is kind of perfection, and Beethoven is work like a dog, and you can become something even with a lot of struggles in your life. When you're listening to the Beethoven, this is the beginning of the 8th Symphony, you probably know the 5th Symphony. So Beethoven was really good at being economical with his musical materials, probably like your English teachers are going to tell you to stick with the theme and don't go too big. This is the first sound you'll hear in the Beethoven Symphony No. 8. Kind of a question, and then he answers his own question. So in the 5th Symphony, you'll hear about 137 versions of ba-ba-ba-bum. In this, you'll hear over 100 in some kind of version. And so if you want something to grab onto while you're listening to this, because we don't have a fancy video for Beethoven, that's what you should grab onto. And the form of this piece is ABA, or sonata form. So we have an exposition, we have a development, and we have a recapitulation. And that brings us to our concert. We're so glad you would be with us. These are members of the Westminster Chamber Orchestra and the wind ensemble and a number of our faculty colleagues called the Westminster Symphony Orchestra. Please welcome them for the Symphony No. 8 by Beethoven. This is Linda Chuniowski. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.